Tuesday, Sunday before the election, why would you go? I get why you want to go to an African American church, but why would you go to Baltimore? I mean, come on. They're so good to you. They always do for you. Why would you go for Elijah Cummings? He's been in the house 15 minutes. He literally hadn't finished one term yet. I said, I just got a feeling this is something we ought to do.
All right.
And if we do it, we'll know whether it was right or not. And so the bishop rolled out the red carpet, thousands of people. And you may remember, we got in some trouble, didn't we? We got in some trouble. People criticized us for having a get out to vote event in a church. They said it was inappropriate.
Church and state.
And as I remember, Elijah reminded people that our constitutional rights, including the freedom of religion, the freedom of assembly, the freedom of speech, depended on people giving voice to them in elections. In the debate. Then, I got to listen to Elijah talk that day. You talk about a lousy deal. It was, I had to follow both the bishop and the at least I'm getting ahead of you and President Obama. In my old age, I'm the warm-up pack. I'm living it. Anyway, Elijah was great. And he ended with his quiet and reasoned and rhythmic voice growing into his gloomy voice by quoting that wonderful verse from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. They who wait upon the Lord will have their strength renewed. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and faint not. He just kept doing more and more. The crowd was going crazy. Over the course of these last few days, I've had a chance to think a lot about Elijah's life. He really did so with Mira and Isaiah, who had one of the greatest one-liners in the history of human affairs. When the Lord asked, whom shall I send and who will go for me? Isaiah said, here am I, Lord, send me. Elijah Cummings spent a whole life saying, send me. I think he did it for a lot of reasons. He loved the fact that his parent, humble, wise, made his a great American story. And he loved that it confirmed his faith, but he knew that without the Constitution, the laws that were passed under it, the rights were guaranteed by it, and the abuses it was designed to prevent, without that Constitution, he would not have been in Congress. And so he said to himself, I am certain every day I will not let this promise be so. And he did his best. And while doing his best and fighting his heart out, sticking up for Hillary and lots of other people, many of them were voiceless and weak and will never be known. While doing all that, he actually made, in one of the most partisan periods in our country's history, a lot of Republican friends. Why did he do that? How did he do that? I think he did it because everybody could see he was a real leader. He was doing what he believed. His heart was in it. And I think he did it because no matter how hard he fought and how passionately he argued, he tried to treat everybody the way he wanted to be treated. You know, you can't run a free society if you have to hate everybody and disagree with them.
Wow. Wow.
You know, sooner or later, if you've been married 45 years and both of you are thinking, you're going to have a disagreement. Sooner or later, if you're in a business or a team, or in a campaign, and you're thinking that you're going to have disagreements. He believed that it's to treat people the way he wanted to be treated. And he believed if everybody accepted his broad, endearing, inclusive definition of one America, where we respect our differences and think what we have in common matters more, and we all live under the same set of rules, and we all believe that under those rules, those of us who have more than we need should do more to help those who don't have enough. Now, that's what we need to believe. And being friends, he was so proud that he could help resolve a personal spat between his Republican congressional friend and new member of the Democratic caucus. But he believed. So here's what I want to leave you with. Elijah spent his working life in the tradition of Isaiah. He went again and again and again. But I think in his lasting legacy to us, we should think again about the prophet Elijah.
Yes.
For this reason. He was about to be killed for his ardent promotion of his faith. Hmm. He hid in a cave, either within or next to Mount Sinai. He received a message from God to go up and stand on top of the mountain and wait for the voice of God to speak to him. So look, he'd already had a pretty hard time just like at the end of the last system. He's already had a pretty hard time. We got to go through this too. Mm-hmm. So there's Elijah standing on the mountain. And a huge wind came so strong it broke the rocks of the mountain. But the Lord was not in the wind.
Preach.
Then an earthquake came, shaking everything. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. Then the fire came. But the Lord was not in the fire. And then, what does the scripture say? A still, small voice.
Yeah.
Elijah, by that point, had gotten rid of all the pomp, all the circumstance, all the glory for the still small voice. I love this thing. I love every minute I ever spent with him, every conversation we ever had. I love his booming voice, but we should hear him now. In the quiet times at night and in the morning when we need courage, when we get discouraged, we don't know if we can believe it anymore. We should hear him. Yeah. Let our Elijah be for us what he himself heard, a still small voice. It keeps us going, keeps us grateful, keeps us happy, and keeps us moving. Thank you.